All right, here we are. Good morning. It is good to be together this morning on this third Sunday of Advent. Today we are celebrating the risen Christ, the child who was born to us, and our theme in celebrating Jesus' birth is joy. Hence my fantastic jacket. In our house, Tracy loves Christmas, and when she found out that I wore this without telling her, because I thought I'd surprise her, she actually got upset because she didn't join in the party. Sorry, Trace. But it is good to be together this morning, both here in the sanctuary and for everybody who's joining online. As we gather to worship the Lord this morning, I would invite us, before Tatiana and Diana come up to lead us in the Advent reading, let's greet one another, welcome them in the name of the Lord this morning.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the third day of Advent. We are going to be reading on joy. I'm going to read on Psalms 126. When the Lord brought Zach back to the captives to Zion, we were like those restored to health. Our mouths are filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it said among the nations,
the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Bring back our captive, Lord-like stream in the Negev. Those who sow with tears will reap with song of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, we return with song of joy, carrying sheaves with them.
The burden of debt weighs heavy on a person's heart and mind. When the debt has been paid, the burden is lifted, and it can feel as though we have a new set of legs to run with, or a new set of lungs that can belt out a favorite song. This Advent season, as we prepare our hearts and minds once again to celebrate the Most High God has lifted from our shoulders because of Jesus, we can, like the psalmist say, the Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. In Him we have hope, in Him we have peace, in Him joy is found. Let us pray. Merciful God of peace, your work spoken by the prophets restores our life and hope. In the midst of difficulties we see and experience, fill our hearts this Christmas season with joy as we contemplate and live in the work of your grace. May your joy pervade our lives as we hold fast to your promise of a new life, which will burst forth like the springs of Negev. Amen.
Won't you stand as we sing Joy to the World? Of his love.
Silently, how silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of His heaven. Oh, hear me, hear His coming, but in this world of sin, when these souls will receive Him still, the dear Christ enters in. Oh, holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great tidings tell. Oh, hope to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel.
Thank you. You may be seated.
The little ones had to stay here. So, Audrey, you're stuck with Mother Hen. Okay, let's pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you have done for us. Your compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Thank you, Lord. And for this reason, we bow before you and we pray that out of your glorious riches, you may strengthen us with power through your Holy Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And I pray that we may have power to grasp how wide, long, high, and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses all understanding. Father, may we be filled to the measure of your fullness. Our souls rest in you. They rest in the promise of new possibilities in the newness of life that you make available to us. Help us to be thankful for our place in your eternal plan for all things. Father, we pray now for the needs of our church. Father, we pray that you will be with all the committees that have been formed to work out a way of our two churches combining, becoming one. We pray, Father, you give us great wisdom. Wisdom to know what your will is. And Father, that we do it according to your divine will. Because ultimately, we want to give honor and glory to you in all things we do. Father, I pray that you be with those amongst us who aren't well. I pray, Father, that you will place your healing hand upon each and every one of them. And Father, that they may feel your touch, and that some way they may be healed. I pray for those who are undergoing tests. I pray that the results may be good. Father, I pray that you be with those who are unable to come out any longer. Be with them, Father, and wherever they are, may they feel they're still part of our community. They're still part of our church, Lord. And I pray that wherever they are, that they may feel your presence, that they may be touched by you. Father, I also pray that you be with the elderly of our church that are going through difficulties. Whatever they are, Father, I pray that you will give them strength to see them through each and every day. Father, I pray that you be with those who have lost a loved one. Father, especially at this time of the year, where we're celebrating Christmas, some of them for the first time are now celebrating Christmas without a loved one. I pray, Father, you fill that void in our lives with your own presence, that, Father, they may feel your love as they're being touched by you. Oh, Father, I pray that you be with Pastor Tyler as he speaks to us from your word. May his words be your words. Bless him so he may be a blessing to us. Pray this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Cornell. Kids, before you guys go off to Sunday school, I'm going to invite you to come sit here in the front rows. What I want to do right now, I was thinking this week, thinking through the sermon, and its sermon is on joy, and the passage the adults are going to be looking at is where Mary comes to visit Elizabeth, and there's this greeting between the two of them, and there's this eruption of joy. For Elizabeth, John in her womb leaps, she says. For Mary, she bursts into song. There's all this explosive kind of language. And so I thought, what could I do to demonstrate or to elicit maybe a bit of wonder or awe? And I hope this works out. We were practicing in our bathtub last night how this is going to work. And so, Joseph, you may want to step back just a little bit. So here we have a bottle. This is not Tyler's magical elixir of super savior serum that we had a few weeks of. It is not wine, no. It is a wine bottle, though. And here we have some water with a little bit of yeast. We're not going to make any bread, although that would be fun as well. And for anyone who's seen YouTube videos on this, this is probably going to be a little bit boring. But if you've never seen a YouTube video on elephant toothpaste, this might be a little bit exciting. And there's a sense of eruption and explosion. Are you guys ready? I am not, because this could go horribly wrong. This, for all of us who's excited about chemistry, like Noel, we're going to cause what's called an exothermic reaction, and this is actually going to be really warm, which we discovered last night. Here we go. Are we ready? All right, explosive. Interesting, bursting with joy, party celebration. I really hope this works, because it'd be better for it to be more explosive than less, because anticlimactic. So I'm nervous. Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
Here we go. Here we go. I hope we have a big enough tray. What we discovered last night as we were doing this in the bathtub, it would go down the drain and then it would come out the overflow part of the drain for a significant amount of time. So this may actually do it for a no, because it is very warm. Not quite burning warm, but very warm. And Noelle learned last night, what is in here is, just so everybody knows, it's hydrogen peroxide that's, instead of 3% like you get at the grocery store, it's 36% hydrogen peroxide. And we learned last night that the guy warned Noel, don't drink it, which I don't know why you would ever think to drink hydrogen peroxide, but he said, make sure you wear gloves when you use it. And we did. We did a few experiments with it, and then we were like, we should try one more time. And I had taken my gloves off, and I forgot. And we did it, and I had no issues. And I handed Noelle the cup that had the peroxide in it, and it actually, there was a drop left on it, and it burnt a hole in her hand. So we learned that the pharmacist that sold it to Noelle was right. Don't get this on your skin. It will burn. And so this, I want us to keep this in mind today as we think about joy, as we think about celebration, as we think about why we gather to worship and the babe that we sing about and talk about and share with one another. Keep this image of explosion and eruption and the joy that bursts not from outside in, but actually from inside out. And so as you guys head off to Sunday school, I'm going to pray for you, and you'll head down to Sunday school in continual preparation for next weekend as we celebrate Christmas Eve together. So let's pray together for our kids and their leaders. Lord God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for these students and their families and the leaders that will guide them. We pray, God, that you would bless them, that we would, they and us too, would continue to grow in an understanding of joy because you have entered into the world, that you have paid for our sins, that you have given us life eternal. And so help us, Lord, to see you, to hear you, to follow you, and to celebrate you with everything we have, that it may burst forth from within us to share to those around us. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, guys, have a great morning. And this time, Ian will come up and read the scripture passage for us.
Most people would say, how do you follow that? Fortunately, I have scripture to follow that. And our reading this morning, and I've resisted the temptation to read it in the King James Version where all the poetry is, so we're going to stay with the NIV. Luke 1, verses 39 to 56. Mary visits Elizabeth and Mary's song. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. May the Lord add his blessing to our reading of his word. Amen.
Thank you, Ian. And thank you, music team, for leading us in worship thus far this morning. Earlier this week, we were talking as a family about movies that we want to watch over the Christmas season. I can't even button up this jacket, it's so obnoxious. We're talking about movies that we wanted to watch over the Christmas season. And there's a number of ones that come up. One was Home Alone, the original Home Alone from back when I was a kid. The other was Elf, which the girls, Tracy and Noelle, absolutely love and I find quite hilarious as well. But the third is The Grinch. Dr. Seuss' book that became a movie, or cartoon at least, and subsequent movies. Because there's something about the Grinch movie that I just really enjoy. I love the rhyming, I love Dr. Seuss's language, all that kind of stuff. But there's this combination, this engagement about who the Grinch is and who the Whos are that really resonates for me. And so my question for us this morning is, how Grinchy are you? How Grinchy are you? And let me give you some indications of how Grinchy you might be, even if you don't know it. As we were exploding things on the stage, and again, it wasn't an explosion, if your concern was, uh-oh, that better not get in the carpet, you might be a little bit Grinchy. If your concerns were, ugh, I hope he doesn't preach too long, you might be a little bit Grinchy, or you might know me too well. There's things in our life, if you're stressed about dinner preparations or what you have to do, as I at times am, you might be a little Grinchy. And one of the most remarkable things, what I love, James, if you can just throw that photo up again, what I love about this picture is that there's this, such a contrast between the Grinch, who is out to destroy Christmas for the Whos, and little Cindy Lou, who is absolutely in awe of all that's going on. She looks at the Grinch with love and compassion and interest about who he might be or what he might bring. She buys into his story that he's Santa Claus because she's seeing the world, as her community does, through a sense of awe and wonder and anticipation and excitement. And so the contrast then is, how Grinchy are we, or, and it's a very awkward sentence, but how Whoville are we? And my hope for us is that we grow more Who-like and less Grinch-like. And if you put that in biblical language, it would be, Paul would say, that you would grow more new person-like and less old person-like. And old being old self, not old in age. There's this tension that exists between us where half of us or part of us is Grinchy, and part of us is Whoville. This year, for us as a church, for many families within our church, has been hectic, has been filled with difficulty. Everyone that I've talked to, I mean, we say it every year, I can't believe how fast the year has gone by, but I can't tell you how many conversations I've had with people here and at the school and in other friend circles that just say, this year has seemed faster and more hectic than any year previous. And the question is for us, has that led us to be more Grinchy or more Whoville-y? The passage that Ian read for us is such an interesting story in the life of Jesus and the life of his aunt or cousin, Elizabeth, and the life of his mother, Mary. Because right before that passage is the passage where Gabriel comes and visits Mary. This, and we talked about it before, this young teenage girl who's visited by an angel and is told that she is now pregnant with the Son of God. And she says, how can that be? I'm a virgin. I mean, they knew how babies were made back then, just as we do now. And Gabriel says to her, the Spirit is going to come on you. God is going to do something literally inside of you. And you are going to bear the Lord of the world, the Son of God. And I can't imagine, and Luke records it, how terrified Mary would have been. And in that terror, in that fear, in that uncertainty of what lies ahead for her, Luke says she gets up and hurries to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she enters Zechariah's home, her uncle's or cousin's home, and greets Elizabeth. And this is where we're going to start. Joy is not circumstantial. The circumstances of Mary's life and Elizabeth's life are bizarre. Mary is told that she's going to be pregnant and with child as a teenager, unwed, that would have completely flipped her world upside down. And Luke doesn't record it, and none of the Gospels record it, and the biblical text doesn't record why Mary got up and left for Elizabeth's place. But my current working theory is this, that her family rejected her. It would make sense. That's exactly the kind of thing that would happen in a shame-based culture where there's a socially unacceptable situation. Mary, they're peasants to begin with, and now she's pregnant, and she's telling stories. Could you imagine going to her parents and saying, I had this visit from an angel, and I'm now pregnant. There's no part of that would say, oh, okay, well, let's take care of you in that kind of context. And so my working theory, and again, and this is not biblical, but my working theory is that Mary was either kicked out by her family or in fear of being kicked out just took off. Because why in the world would a teenage girl travel across the country? And I mean, it's not across Canada. We're not talking hundreds of miles. But why she would leave her home and go to the home of a relative. Her circumstances were terrible. Her fears were elevated. What am I going to do in raising this child? How am I going to handle this situation? And she goes to Elizabeth and greets Elizabeth, who she's been told is also pregnant. And I wonder if Elizabeth is thinking the same way. At my age, past childbearing years, how in the world am I going to deliver this child and live? Infant mortality was not good. And the risk of dying at a good age was high. And the risk of dying at an older age, of past childbearing years, was increased. And so Elizabeth's circumstances, although in the previous context when she's told by Gabriel of her pregnancy, she feels like, I'm going to be elevated. I'm now finally doing the thing that I'm supposed to do in this community as a woman. I'm doing the thing that I'm supposed to do in this marriage as a woman. I'm bearing a child. I have no doubt that fear and trepidation would have filled her life. And so these two women, this young child and this, you know, not elderly, but senior lady come together in a circumstance that is far less than ideal. And they share the news together, and all that happens is an eruption of joy. All that happens is a realization of what's happening amongst them. They burst forth in anticipation of what God is going to do. Mary has gone from being fearful and leaving home again in whatever the circumstances are, terrified of what's going to happen, and she greets Elizabeth, and Elizabeth's response to her is, when I heard your greeting, the baby inside of me leapt. The Spirit filled me up. I was excited beyond rationality. And so joy, we have to remember, is not circumstantial. In the midst of difficult situations, God is still at work in us. And that's number two. Joy is from within us as God does his work, and it erupts when we share with others. This young girl comes to the door, and imagine a reasonably modest house, knocks on it, greets her cousin, and says, I'd have nowhere else to turn, perhaps. I'm pregnant by the Holy Spirit, perhaps. Elizabeth, can you take me in? I've been kicked out of my house, perhaps. And Elizabeth's eyes open wide. Because that movement of the child within her isn't just a child kicking, it's a leaping with joy from the Spirit that happens. That God is doing a work inside of them, and they have an embrace and an exchange, and something happens that really solidifies for Mary what is going on. That God is at work in the midst of the difficult situation she finds herself in. Do you believe the same thing? Do you recognize in the difficult circumstances that you're facing, and we can't get rid of them, we can't avoid death or illness or oftentimes relational difficulty, finances. We can't avoid these things. We can't magically snap our fingers and make them go away, and there's no promise in Scripture that says that it will happen that way. But in the midst of these situations that God has placed us or leads us or that we encounter, do you believe that God is at work in your life? That he wants to do something miraculous within you. That he wants to not change necessarily your circumstance, but how you might see it. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt, and blessed is she. Blessed is you. Blessed am I," Elizabeth says, "who believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." Do you believe that? That God sees you and knows you and wants to be engaged with you in relationship in whatever circumstance you find yourself in? He is present amongst us. And we learn that most deeply when we share with others, when we talk with one another, when we ponder together what is going on in our lives and the challenges we're facing and what it is that God might be doing amidst those challenges. You see, Elizabeth could have greeted Mary with, "Oh, crap, a teenage pregnant girl, I've got to deal with that. I don't have enough shame in my family as someone who hasn't had a child past childbearing years." But that's not what she did. She takes this teenager in and not just goes, "Hey, Mary, come in, I'll take care of you." She says, "Why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" Mary's childbearing elevates not just who she is, but how Elizabeth sees her. And Elizabeth sees the honor and the privilege and the joy that she has to be able to travel this journey together with her. And the end of the passage says that Mary stayed with her 3 months. We find out before that Elizabeth had been pregnant 6 months, which meant that Mary came and actually cared for Elizabeth. They engaged in this journey of uncertainty together. You and I are created to be in relationship with God for sure, but we are created to be in relationship with one another and to share in our joys and our fears that we might see collectively what God is trying to do in us and through us together. Joy comes from within as God does his works in us, and it erupts when we share it with one another. Do you believe that God could actually use you to make his joy known to someone else? That as we share in what God is doing with whatever uncertainty we may face, that as we work that out together as people, as communities, as families, that we would get a clearer picture of what God is really trying to do and where he's trying to lead us and what he's going to accomplish in and through us? We don't experience joy independently, we gather to celebrate joy together. And so if you think about the things that we do, we celebrate birthdays and anniversaries. We celebrate Christmas time and Easter. We gather at Thanksgiving and graduations. There's so many milestones where we celebrate together because we are built for community. We're created to engage with one another, to be together, to share what it is that God is doing in and through us. And this passage concludes, this section concludes with Mary's song. And Mary's song is such an incredible story. If we pay attention to what's going on there, it's the history of Israel. It's a recognition that what God has said, the stories that have been passed down from generation to generation to generation, were actually now becoming true and taking shape. And so where we end this morning is that joy is rooted in what God has done, a belief in that, what God is doing as we share together as the people of God of what he's up to amongst us, and we anticipate what he will one day do. My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of our humble state, of our situation, that this young teenage girl could actually bear the Son of God. The story of God is always taking the least expected and raising them up, that the brokenhearted would be comforted, that the poor would be fed, that the lonely would be known. All generations, Mary says, will call me blessed. They will look to Mary and say, I can't believe God did it that way. But that's always been his story, hasn't it? He took Moses, a guy who had no interest in leading his people, and invited him and called him to lead his people out of God's people out of Egypt. He called Abraham, someone who didn't know who God was, from his foreign country over to choose him and populate the world and make the God known through him. He chose Esther to save his people. He chose John, this crazy man that is born to a mom late in life, to create the way for Jesus to come. He chose a group of 12 seemingly dope heads who'd never understood it, who kept getting it wrong, and one who actually betrayed Jesus, that we, you and I, are here this morning. God works through the least of these. He considers the humble estate because that's the people that God can use. Is those who pay attention to what he has done, is doing, and will one day do, not for their own benefit, but for the work of God in and through them. The Mighty One has done great things for me, Mary says. His mercy extends to those who fear him. He's performed mighty deeds with his arm. He deals with the proud. He brings down rulers from their thrones, and he lifts up those who keep their eyes on him. He filled the hungry with good things, but sent the rich away. When our loves get mixed up, when our gods get confused, God just says, I don't need you. He invites us to pay attention to what he is doing. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised. Joy comes when we pay attention to what God is doing. And God does things in the darkest and most difficult of circumstances. And so as we continue to gather this Christmas season, as we continue to celebrate what he's done, my encouragement to each of us is to consider, am I approaching it Grinchy-like? Or am I approaching it with open eyes in wonder of what God has done and is doing in you right now and will one day accomplish throughout all generations? If a young, pregnant teenager could bear and carry the Son of God, how much more can he do with all of us when the Holy Spirit resides within us, leads us into fellowship and community together, and calls us to proclaim that the kingdom has come and that the King's name is Jesus. For that, we can celebrate with joy. Let's pray together. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of life you have given us in Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you take the humble and the weak. You take those who are confused and turned around. You take the young and the old, the rich and the poor. And you invite us to lay down our identities in all of those things, and to see what you are doing in us and who you're calling us to be. And so we pray, Lord, this Christmas time that you would work your spirit amongst us, that we would grow a little less grinchy and a little more like you, trusting in the midst of whatever circumstance we find you, that you are at work and we can share that project, that work, that transformation with those around us. Help us to see you, to hear you, and to follow you together. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Won't you stand as we sing, I Stand Amazed, as a response to the sermon? Singing how
took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own, and he bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone, singing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall
join me in the prayer for the offering. Lord God, we have gathered for worship through the singing of your gospel, through the hearing of your word, through praying and interacting with one another. And so we pray, Lord, that as we give to the work of your mission in and through this church, that you would bless it abundantly, that we would give with joyful hearts, that we would be good stewards of the resources you have given to us to go out and make disciples, to alleviate poverty, to care for those in need. And so we pray, Spirit, move us, direct us, and guide us as we give of our finances, as we give of our time, as we give of our lives to one another and to the mission you've called us to. In your name we pray. Amen. Please have a seat. I've got just a few announcements before we conclude for the morning. Today is the last Sunday to donate physical items to the Pregnancy Care Center. The box, I believe, is out there, and there's another box up here. So if you've brought items today, please deposit in there. Of course, money can be donated to the Pregnancy Care Center year-round through their website. And so that's something we just get behind because people need to be cared for. And so if you have those, today is the last day that we're collecting stuff. It will be taken down to the center this week. So if you have something, please drop it off. The mini market last weekend, thank you to everyone who contributed. Another $1,000 was raised through that. For the El Salvador team. And so that is fantastic. Thank you to everyone who's continuing to contribute to the team that will be heading to El Salvador early in the new year. And we look forward to hear the stories of what God is going to do in and through that team as they build houses for those who currently don't have any. Next Sunday is Christmas Eve, second last Sunday of the year. And we're going to have a special, it's going to be a combined service between us and Goodtree, or as we should be saying, the new church that we are. And the kids are doing a presentation, and so parents, if you're going to be here, please confirm with the Sunday school team, but also please be here at 9:30 for a dress rehearsal. It's a little bit elaborate what we need to set up, and so if you can be here to help be in that and make sure we get all the X's on the floor where we need them and that kind of thing, that would be fantastic. As well, in the new year, for our first Sunday together as the new church officially, January 14th, we're going to have a child dedication service. And what a better way to start a new season of life together than to celebrate new kids that are part of the congregation. All right, task force met yesterday. And so the task force, for those who don't know, is a group of people made up of people from each church who are kind of blazing the trail, figuring out how we're going to unite these two churches together in terms of the processes involved. And here's one decision we made for sure based on everyone who contributed to the survey about church time. The new church time will be mid-morning. And so it was overwhelming across the 98 responses. I get about 75% of that said mid-morning. And then we had made a decision about what time that would be, and then I got an email this morning from someone. I sent that out to leadership, got an email from someone saying, we should consider this. And I thought, okay, before we announce a specific time, we need to consider this last bit. Decision-making is hard. That is what I'm learning as we're going along, forging a new trail. It's difficult, but good. So continue to pray for the task force. Ongoing things to remember: next weekend, Christmas Eve, 11 o'clock. New Year's Eve, the following Sunday, 11 o'clock, and a combined candlelight service with all four churches in the building next Sunday at 7 p.m. And so it's going to be a full house. Next Sunday is going to be a lot of fun for our candlelight service together. That is all the announcements for this morning. If you are new with us this morning or visiting from out of town, we welcome you, get a chance to say hi to you. Thank you for joining together as God's people here in the sanctuary and for everybody online. Let's stand for the benediction together. Father God, we thank you for the gift of life together. We thank you that your joy resides in us as you do your work amongst us. And so we pray that your Spirit would continue to guide us in all things, that the fellowship of Jesus Christ would unite us together, that the love of the Father would rest upon you in the places you inhabit to proclaim that Christ is born today and he is risen indeed. We thank you, Father, for the gift of life together. In your name we pray. Amen. Have a fantastic afternoon, and let's enjoy some food together following the service.